This is a short bio of Professor Newth, who was a former president and vice president of SAMS. And I'm not sure how long it has been, this lecture has been running, but it is an annual feature within our annual general meeting, which we've just concluded. So we're going to do something different this time, this year. Normally we just have a lecture, but this time we're going to have what we're calling a personal perspectives of the marine environment. I'm just going to leave all of the others to introduce themselves, but we've got a sound project which is going to kick us off. We're then going to have the lecture, which is going to be given by John Spicer, Professor John Spicer. I'll give a brief introduction to John when we reach that point. We then have some further music, and then we have in the room through here, the purple room there, we've got some fashion and also some light projects. So I think this is quite a departure from our normal event. So I really don't know very much about this next part of the project. So I'm going to actually ask. The team who are going to actually perform for us in one way or another, and I think it's Nick who's going to tell us what this is all about, aren't you?
I am. You good?
Oh.
Not Nick.
This is Nick, and this is Ben. Ben is
one of our... That's about 3 years ago, 2013, there was a very interesting meeting in this very room, and it was an attempt to get artists and scientists to get together and do work that was exploring the capabilities of either and seed new things and so on. Anybody who was there at that meeting will remember a photograph of a chap holding a goat, and it was all about the shirt he was wearing. So it was an interesting afternoon, and I actually crept out. I went, this is not for me, I'm a scientist. This touchy-feely art stuff is just getting a bit too weird. I left. There was some things carried on from that, and they got even weirder, so I won't talk about those. A little while after, Nick, who'd also been in the room, who'd come to a very similar conclusion, approached and said, actually, do you think we could do something? And so Nick wanted to explore underwater sound. I'm a marine mammalogist interested in underwater acoustics in the sea, and immediately hit it off. We've had some great conversations about sound under the sea. We were very sceptical about his capabilities. He went off, made hydrophones, recorded in the sea, did some great things. It's been really exciting. And so you're going to get a little sniff of that in a moment. So I'll shut up.
I'm not going to bore you, but I always thought it'd be good to start off with a joke. So I've had facts, amazingly, Donald Trump's new marine biology plan. can you all see it? as Ben said, the crack was that Credit Scotland had a fund in 2013, and it was trying to find ways of getting artists involved with science. And from that, I had an idea which became something called the Deep Sea Light. And the idea was to try and find sort of music, a crossover between music and science that would be entertaining, but not really like a documentary, something that would engage people, particularly with life below the waves, where sound is so important. And so we talked about ways of trying to find a project that would cover that ground. What we've ended up with is essentially four programs, so it's four different audio streams. It's done in surround sound, and we named after four species, because the sounds that we take from their particular ecosystems. But there's been some synthesis along the way, as well as some actually original audio. The partners in the project, Ben, Denise, and Rianne from here, Phil Day, Captain Phil Day, and Lorna Hunter from the Northern Lighthouse Board. I'll explain where they came in. Also, David Ferguson, who runs the Arden American Trust, the Lighthouse Trust. And also I have a supporting artist who works in marine materials called Anna Raven from Ardgower. And the idea is to bring all those themes together to something that has to be entertaining but actually have some sort of impact. The methods that were used, I'm trying to find scientific here, forgive me if I don't put it off. but I'm wearing a tweed jacket, which apparently gives me some of the methods we use are fairly interesting. The idea was that we had, we used Ardmaglen Lighthouse because it was an interesting, sort of almost like a metaphor, that it's the last thing before we go into the ocean, so it's kind of that midway point where you can move in and out what might be the marine world. So the idea is that I convolve the lighthouse, and convolving is a recording technique. It was developed for films, essentially. So if you're watching a film, a badly dubbed film, and suddenly the voice comes in to either replacing a swear word or it's dubbed a new language, and it sounds foreign. The idea was that you could record the acoustic space of any space inside an abbey or a van or in any room, and then once you recorded the space, you could then you'd do something like use a starter pistol, very sharp sound. You record that sound, take it back to the studio, and using algorithms, you get a reverb in a room. But if you have the original sound, just the starter pistol sound with no reverb, you can put the two together, and what you get through a subtractive process is essentially what happens to that sound with any given space. That's about as technical as I'm going to get. Okay? The idea is it means that you can get things, if you're back in the studio and you record a voiceover, you can put them in St Paul's Cathedral, or you can put them in a van going on the motorway, and when you dub them in, they sound as if they were there at the time. And that's very handy when I want to do something with a Ardmaglen Lighthouse, because if you listen to the project online, we put a voice, Marianne's voice, in the lighthouse singing a song. And the idea is it's a surround sound experience. So if you close your eyes and listen to it, it gives you a very, very accurate idea of actually the sound of in the lighthouse. So that's the reason we convolved the lighthouse. I built a rig that I took out onto Summer Bay, which is four hydrophones on the corner of a floating rig. And the hydrophone has to be lowered at different heights. The general idea being that I record different things. Of course, anyone who's been out in the ocean realises that all I recorded was different levels of pistol shrimp. They were really spectacularly good, it's very, very good. But the idea is that you can then move, we could then take it all the way across the bay, because not only the species that we might record, but also that we could actually pick up sounds of underwater stones and rocks and sand moving. So the idea of a rig was that it recorded, again, in surround sound, four different hydrophones, the different sounds under the water. We then also did ambisonic recording, which is a four-capsule microphone on the shoreline, and same sort of thing, capturing in surround sound the environment. So all of these elements we kind of put together to try to make a program. As you'll hear, the first piece we're going to play is from the program called the Minke Whale. And it's not just, the idea wasn't just to be sort of rooted on things necessarily to do with Summer Bay, where the project was based. We had all sorts of fun and interesting things coming in, but they all have an element which is associated with how we see the sea and life beneath it. The idea being to try to put people into like a submersive experience so that they might get a feel for what it's like once you have intrusive sounds come into the environment. So that's about it. Okay. So I'm not going to say any more. We've got to explain about the first piece.
Okay. There's a song incorporated into this first piece, the Greenland Whaling Song. It's the one we're going to sing first. First of all, I'd like to say, here it actually does sound like he knows what he's doing, because I always accused him of recording music by going into the studio and stabbing, hopefully, at a few buttons. But actually, he does know what he's doing. He hauled me out with those hydrophones and things as well into the boat, and it was very interesting. For me, music is all about voices and how sound works with audience or with environment. And to hear sound working in a completely different way, it's almost like a different language underwater, is really fascinating. And that's partly the reason why we're playing with two different languages in the songs that we're singing you today. This is one of the best known of the whaling songs. And my mother, the Gaelic singer Kenna Campbell, has a real gift for translation and turning translations into songs that could have been originated in Gaelic. They're so pleasurable to sing. And so we've got a kind of half and half experience for you here, so above and below the water, you can decide which language belongs where.
is a dream world, silent, vast, mystic, unreal, lonely beyond words, beauty that haunts one, majesty all its own, inhabited by strange, weird creatures. In this submerged world, queer, unreal lights play across the ocean floor. Strange fish peer out of unexpected corners. Forests of gently undulating seaweed. Gaudy shells, which at the touch of the diver's foot become animate and scuttle away. The camera can look so much farther afield. Merciful powers, what's this eerie shape? There it is. Look out, octopus! The crawling, irresistible, slimy, death-dealing monster of the seafloor. And he's behind the diver. What a chance he takes. Good man, make him see. Oh, strange indeed are the wonders. Eight great, immensely powerful arms, each with its two rows of deathly suckers. Ooh, look out, that slithering death is right on you. You crush your bones into jelly. Look out, boy, look out.
Cushion brought the fig now, like a sire for a kind.
Thanks very much. We will be back with another sequence from a completely different marine experience in a little while. Thanks very much.
I'm looking at Anushka. This is what we're going to have to do. We have to move your mic, I'm afraid. Is John's lecture is on here somewhere.
Yes.
Right. Can you see it?
It's down in your left-hand corner.
That one.
That's it.
Excellent. Right, anyway, now it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Professor John Spicer. I've known John for many years, and I know you're in for a real treat, actually. He's a brilliant lecturer. And John is actually going to be lecturing on a topic that I'm very keen on, actually, and that's plankton, and also about a man whose name was given to the lab that I was most recently working in before I came here, the Sir Frederick Holliday Foundation. And so I'm also interested in that and the history of science, so it's going to be, I'm looking forward to this, John. But just by way of introduction, John, as you will be able to tell in a minute, is actually Scottish, and he did his BSc in Zoology in Glasgow, and also his PhD there. And then bravely went across the pond to Canada to do some postdoc work there, and then came back as a lecturer in Zoology in Sheffield University. And since 2001, he has been a professor of marine zoology at Plymouth University, which is where I first got to know John. John is a notable marine scientist. He's published loads of papers and is a
a really keen educator. He has had 25 successful PhD students, and I'm sure for every one of them, that's been a real treat. He's also either written or co-authored 4 books, and including a popular book on biodiversity, which I have got, actually. And he tells me that he loves playing the guitar, and any Islay malt whiskey, which I think we might better do something about that. And walk up. So John, thank you very much for coming. It's a long way from Plymouth, as I know, and but I'm sure your trip won't be wasted on us, at least. So, John. Is it time to work?
It's lovely to be with you. I didn't realise it was going to be so musical. I'd have brought my own guitar and just done it all in music. You might not have thought that that was quite a good idea, but I would have really enjoyed it. It's funny, isn't it? I mean, here I am. I'm a professional scientist. I mean, a very, very wide variety here. But what I've chosen to talk about involves science and is actually deeply involved with science, but it's much more human. Yeah. What do I mean by that? I mean, there are some people who are historians of science, and they go in and they look into the background and they dig it all out. Now, I don't have the training in history. I've got some in philosophy and some in theology and some in science, but I don't have in history. And so I'm not going to be the charlatan and say I'm going to do a beautiful historical exposé of these gentlemen. I just don't have the skills to do that. You know, you need to be a good expert in history to do it. What I will do is I'll share with you some of the sorts of things that I think about. It doesn't sound quite as grand, but as a scientist, I'm fascinated by why people do science. I'm fascinated by what makes scientists tick and what other people perceive when they hear and see scientists. Peter Medawar, who's a very famous scientist, said the most boring thing you can actually read is the biography or autobiography of a scientist. And no one laughed when he said it. They just all went, So I'm fascinated by what makes people tick, particularly scientists tick. And I'm interested in, when you look at great lives, what does it teach you? It's really interesting in the Christian New Testament, there's a part that says, consider the lives of those who have gone before you. I think that's a pretty good piece of advice, whether you're agnostic, atheistic, or a devout believer. Consider the lives of those who have gone before you. So although the word plankton's here, I assure you that Nick knows far more about plankton than I would ever know. I've worked in krill, and they're not real plankton. They're just too big. Plankton and the sea, of the sea and of the mind, when Hardy met Garstang. This is Sir Alistair Hardy, who, as Nick has said, the foundation is named after for basically looking at how plankton has changed over the last 75 years in the world's oceans. This guy's been really, really influential. Here he's marrying. This is 3rd of December 1927, for those that don't remember it. This is Sylvia Garstang, whose father was Walter Garstang. Walter Garstang was there when the Marine Biology Association opened its lab in the Hoe on the first day in August 1888. Two substantial figures, Walter Garstang and Sir Alistair Hardy. And I want to look a little bit at when Hardy met Garstang, the interaction between them, a little bit about their science, a little bit about what makes them tick, and a little bit about their talents. And from those things, I want to try and draw out. I'm not going to lecture you, you know, what I want you to take away from this lecture. I would quite like to challenge just some of your views in the same way as what these guys have done, challenge my views. So that's it. It's quite a small aim, and hopefully it should be almost fun. Just to say right at the front, one of the reasons that I literally ran as soon as Nick said, would you do the Newth lecture, was because David Newth taught me developmental biology in his sort of last years at Glasgow. He was absolutely inspirational. He wasn't there that much because he was involved with so many other things. An incredible both medical and sort of experimental zoologist. I mean, he really did experimental embryology, not just looking at how things develop, but going in and manipulating it in a way where you understood. He was one of the chief people that do that. You have an amazing person as part of the history of SAMS. And what's also interesting, and we'll come to this, is that some of the things that I remember, because he wouldn't lecture, we sat round and discussed things in a group. And this was at Downhill. He didn't even go to the university. This is the zoology building when I joined. It's in black and white. How depressing is that? Downhill was up from there, and it was a big, big house. And we would sit in this house, and it was the place that they talked about developmental biology and embryology. A lot of the stuff that you see today in terms of all the different omicses, a lot of that thinking, I remember hearing the proto of that from David and a lot of the people that he had there. It's quite exciting, really. I forgot to bring it down. It's in Nick's office. I actually have a copy of a little book that he did in the sort of biology, Society of Biology. It's called Animal Development. It's about 30 pages, and it's totally utterly out of date, but it's a foretaste of what we're getting now in terms of the way that genetics has changed our understanding of development and evolution. So when I say it's a delight to give a lecture in this man's honour, that's not just a perfunctory statement, it's genuine. So, Plankton of the Sea. Here's one of Alistair Hardy's drawings. I won't ask the planktonologist here to identify which species it is, although they should be able to, I'm sure. Plankton of the Sea. 1925, Alistair Hardy sets off on the discovery. He's got a job. He's got a real job. And that real job is to go down to the Southern Ocean on behalf of the British government and work out how do the fisheries in the Southern Oceans work. And his particular job is to look at the plankton that's there. Now, he's got a bit of experience because Sir Arthur Hardy, born in the sort of almost at the turn of the century, did his degree in Oxford, which was great. But then his degree was, what do you call it? It was disturbed by the First World War, basically. But during the war, he got to do quite a lot of fun things, which is extraordinary. Some not so fun things, but some fun things. Like, he loved flying, he loved the air, and he got a chance to join the Air Corps. And one of the first things he was doing was trying to look at the colour changes in the ocean as a way of telling something about the sea, in particular the things that were in it. And he spent quite a lot of time that. And for those of you who know about colours and the change in the sea, plankton's a big part of that. And he got to play around with that. Then he got put off a little bit by chasing after a worm that no one ever cared about in Naples, but fortunately enough came to his senses and got a job on HMS Discovery. He had also been influenced by this man, Walter Garstang. This was 1925. 1921, he went down to Plymouth to do a course, the Easter course, which was really, really popular in Plymouth, where people came from all over the world, i.e. Cambridge and Oxford, and they would study marine biology under some amazing people. And Garstang taught Alistair there, and he also introduced him to his daughter as well, which was a big part of it. And Garstang, as we'll see, knew his plankton really, really well. And a lot of the advice that Alistair took when he went on the discovery was stuff that he'd taken, or he would talk to Garstang about. If you look at the discovery reports, every decent university library with the name library attached to it has got these discovery reports where you can go and look at them. And they're works of art. They're pieces of science, but they're works of art. And the meticulous nature of the report that he did and another fellow called Gunther, really, really nice, describing all the different sort of laboratory conditions they had, all the different zooplankton. Okay, it took a long time to write up. They would have lost their funding if they were applying for NERC funding today. You can't do that sort of thing. But yeah, I think it's because they did it properly. Does that sound too judgmental? And here's a page from the discovery report with the lab. It's beautiful to read. It's beautiful to read, even if you're not really into science, just to look at the way that these people thought that facts were really important. And then when they said something about the facts, they were really clear about the difference between the two things. What you could see, hear, smell, see, and touch, and what you could infer from it. Really, really, really clever. A real beautiful thing to read. And of course, it was actually just before he went on the Discovery cruise that he got some ideas that really have changed Nick's life. Because one of the things he noticed was that when you were looking at plankton of any form, it wasn't just evenly distributed. For some reason, the gods had not just said, right, okay, we're going to take this stuff called plankton and we're going to just smear it over the surface of the oceans. And basically, you go to one part of the ocean and pick it out, and it's the same as the other bit. you know, homogeneous. It's just not like that. It's really, really patchy. And not only is it patchy, but it doesn't stay within those patches for very long. You go one day and there's a patch here and a patch here. You go back the next day and flipping heck, it's reversed. How do you study something like that? How on earth do you start to get your head around something which is there one day and not the next? And yet, if you're going to understand the way the oceans work, particularly then, at a time at the turn of the 20th century where people were really concerned about fisheries and how they worked and knew that plankton was important, how do you begin to get a handle on that? And so he had this idea of using a way of collecting plankton continuously. Now, it looks like a V2 bomb, sorry, from the Second World War, but this here is the continuous plankton recorder, which, again, I'm not going to tell you details, we can just get Nick up and get you to tell you all about it. And if it's really, really bad, you're welcome to come up and stand. Basically, it's a way of sampling the oceans continuously, and you drag it along behind any ship that will allow you to do it. The nice thing is funding has always been crap in this country for science. And so what he did was he basically went to friends and shipping companies and said, would you drag my device behind your ship, please? Okay, we'll do that for you. And through that, he's managed to get this strange-looking machine to go through the world's oceans for the last 75 years. The idea developed a little bit before the discovery, but on the discovery, he spent ages, and he built this. He didn't just sort of call up Lockheed and say, actually, I want you to build me a continuous plankton sampler. He did it from scratch, by himself. Well, with a couple of people who helped. Here's the original plan. It's in the Discovery books as well. Really, attention to detail. And I said in his writing, there's attention to detail, but when you look at the way this is planned, the attention to detail is lovely. Some people have been very, very critical of this in the sampling method. But I'll tell you something. You try and do it. You know, and it's, wasn't that what Roosevelt said? It's okay for people to stand at the sidelines and say, oh, you should do this and you should do that. He didn't say, well, this is blooming difficult. What we're going to do? He got down and built something and it sort of worked. And when people said, oh, it doesn't really work as well, well, you do it. Except he wasn't that nasty because he was a nice man. He got a lot of his plankton experience from Garstang. Garstang was about 30 years his junior. This is him here, as far as we're aware, taking some measurements off the coast of Plymouth. He was 20. He'd got a degree from Oxford, even though he was extremely ill, barely got his degree. And he was thinking of doing medicine. In fact, when he went to university, he was going to do medicine. Fortunately enough, he met a real human being who said, oh, zoology is what it's all about. And so he did zoology. And when he graduated, he really wasn't terribly well. And a fellow called Bourne, who was up at Oxford at the same time, who was going to be really heavily involved with the marine station in Plymouth, said to him, why don't you come and work as my dog's body? You know, I think it's called assistant director. But, you know, enough said, really. And so that's what he did. And he turned up in sort of August, well, July 1888, and basically got stuck in. I mean, there was no one there when he arrived. He walked into the lab and it was empty. Cunningham and Bourne were out collecting or something, I don't know. And he tidied the lab and he took a canoe out and he went round the island. And then he found somewhere to stay, 20-year-old guy. And then for the next couple of weeks, he got really stuck in to sampling and finding out what was there. Because the reason that the MBA, the Marine Biology Association, was set up in Plymouth was because people wanted to understand fisheries. There was a lot of concern in Britain about fisheries. And so here we have this attempt to set up a marine station which would look at all the different parts that made fisheries work. And so his job as assistant naturalist was to cover for Bourne and Cunningham whenever they were away, but also just to collect everything collectible from wherever you can get it. Now, we know a lot about this because his diaries from 1887 to 1892 are present in the Marine Biology Association just now. No one had ever looked at them, but they're all there. And so we're able to go and just see the amount of effort that this man put into collecting, mainly plankton. I mean, to be honest, he did everything. He actually did everything. You know, there wasn't a group that he didn't work on, but the plankton just absolutely fascinated him. It fascinated him. How do you sample them? You know, because you can't just go and say, pick one up. Oh, look, there's a copepod. I mean, you can do that if it's in a small jar, but not if it's in the ocean. how do you sample them? So what one of his friends did is they got a garden pump for pumping water and actually put it over the side of the boat and did that and filtered it and found it was quite good at collecting plankton. Really quite smart ways of doing things. But more than that, he made notes in all the plankton that he found. This is just a small picture from his diary stroke notebook. And here you've got some little larvae of marine invertebrates that he's been drawing, he's got notes on. And this book is packed full of insightful little observations that we now take for granted. But he was actually one of the first people to record them. He wrote down the natural history as much as he could. But not just the natural history. He also tried to do experiments with them as well. He tried to manipulate them to try and understand how they worked. Now, to be honest, it's difficult, isn't it? Because when you're starting off in any subject, you need the patterns, and then you come with the explanations. Well, here's a whole bunch of folk who are trying to do patterns and explanations at the same time. He's not just content to say, this here, that's a Carcinus manus zoea, and give it a name, therefore it means something. He wants to know, well, why would you do that? Carcinus manus is a crab. And it doesn't look anything like a shore crab, and it's living there. It's got a blooming big spike out of its back. Why has it got that? Or if you're a crab that lives under the sand, what do you do to breathe? How do you do that? So he was fascinated by how things actually worked, and he's got this meticulous notebook where he's going through making all these detailed observations for the first time, stuff that we now sort of take for granted. He was in the Marine Biology Association up until about 1892 when the diaries finish. And then he got a job at Oxford, and then he got a job at Manchester, and then he was finally taken on by the fisheries people, the ISIS, the sort of council that was going to explore the oceans, probably one of the greatest events of the 20th century in terms of oceanography, discovering that the world actually did sort of want to get together and understand their fisheries. His time in Plymouth is really interesting. We'll come to a little bit more in a minute, but here's what used to be the YMCA in Plymouth. He spent a lot of time there because that's where you went if you wanted to talk science. It's really interesting. Him, Bourne, Cunningham, and a couple of other people, visitors from the Marine Biology Association, basically the staff, they would meet on a Wednesday evening and they would talk science. But it would be very, very sort of detailed, hard science of what they were doing. So he would talk about how snails would metamorphose. Someone else would talk about light organs. But at the YMCA, there was actually real debate. It's strange, isn't it? I mean, we think of it now as YMCA. It's a bit funny and it's funny clothes. But there, in Plymouth and in many other places, organisations like that was one of the few places where you could get good discussion of things in a way that maybe we've lost today. And there's a little account from his diary, 9th of November, he goes along. He's actually almost a paid-up member of the YMCA. But he goes along, and there's a fellow, this Walrond, reading a paper on the evolution of man. And there's quite heated debate. And if you want, you can go to the newspapers at the time, and they give detailed accounts of the scientific explanations. Now, these are ordinary people reading this. They're going and reading the detailed stuff. But what wound Garstang up was the fact that here you had a debate where people on both sides of an argument about the evolution generally, but the evolution of man. But the fact was that none of them would defend or oppose it because of the facts. Because of the way he was scientifically trained, he thought the facts were actually important. Now, I know that should be axiomatic and we teach students that, but it's not always the case when you read some people's scientific work. He thought the facts were really important, and if you're going to argue, the facts were actually important in an argument. Okay. One of the first major things he did, I mean, basically he was a dog's body when he started the Marine Biology Association. When he started at Lowestoft, and here it was, this was fishery stuff, he was given big responsibility, made a lot of enemies in the scientific community and the fishing community because he was very, very hard about the facts were actually important. Huxley had said a few years previously that actually that the oceans could probably sustain fishing as long as the technology didn't change. And then this book appeared by this Professor McIntosh and Garstang quotes, in a remarkable book, The Reserves of the Sea, boldly adopts the view that man's operations and the means of capture at his disposal are insufficient to affect the perennial abundance of sea fishes. In other words, if we do business as normal, the oceans are fine. This paper, published in the Journal of the Marine Biology Association by Garstang, he sets out his intent quite straightforwardly. I have endeavoured to bring together the most precise and reliable evidence available as to the recent and present condition of the great trawl and line fisheries of England and Wales. And if you go to that scientific paper, even without a scientific background, you can follow his argument because it is beautifully constructed. The evidence is there, and all you need to do is just be smarter than a lentil and you can actually follow all the way through. You don't need a scientific training. Has he simplified it? Not more than he has to. But what he does care about is a proper argument to see what's actually true and what's not, based on the evidence. It's lovely. It's really, really nice. We'll leave that just now. I said he liked doing experiments rather than just looking at things. One of the things he introduced, and you folk who live in Scotland will know a lot about this, is the idea of experimental introduction of fish to areas, the manipulation. Can you take fish from an area and introduce them to an area and farm them? It was him that actually brought up that idea of experimentally engineering, if you like, for fisheries and for aquaculture. He gave a talk in 1927, and that was the main basis of the talk. But he tried it. He tried it with place. He tried it over quite a long period of time, taking place from one place, excuse me, and putting the place in another place. And it sort of worked. So this is a man who is passionate about the idea that science can do things. He sees it as improving the world, but he sees the science itself as important in its own right, and having got the science right, that you can then infer something that's worthwhile from that. He went to the University of Leeds. He got a professorship. So he started off being dog's body at the MBA. He still thought about being a doctor, but then thought better of it. Worked for at Lowestoft, and then got a lectureship in the University of Leeds in 1907. Like many of us who get lectureships, it ruins your life for a while, because basically you have to put something together for the students who are turning up. And he put a degree course together at the University of Leeds where there wasn't one before, and that took most of his time. So what he did was he spent a lot of the time, instead of going into the lab, because lab work is actually hard. For those of you who haven't suffered the torture of lab work, where you work all day and then someone says to you, "What have you done today?" and you burst into tears. it's difficult to get across the worthless feeling you have at the end of a lab day that hasn't gone well. And if you're putting a course together in a university, you don't have the luxury of actually doing things with your hands. And so he went to thinking about a lot of the stuff that he'd been doing at the MBA, particularly the looking at the larval animals that lived in the plankton. Now, in his day, from about 1866 or 1870 onwards, there was one thing that dominated biology. Now, if I said, what is it, many of you say, Darwin's idea of natural selection. Sort of. Actually, Darwin's idea, when it came out, it sort of exploded and then went away a bit until the 1920s. And it took the discovery of quite a few geneticists to bring Darwin's theory back to life. What really dominated the imagination, if you look in not just in the scientific literature, but the popular literature, was the view of a man called Haeckel, the German Darwin. He responded to Darwin's ideas by saying, not only did animals evolve, but in fact, here is a grand scheme of how the world works. You know, the Brian Cox theory of everything. We love theories of everything. We adore theories of everything. Haeckel had one. And he said that basically what you have is the whole of life is just one sort of continuous development where you're going from a single cell all the way to an individual. But on the way, you relive your entire evolutionary history. And so you go through a fish stage. Many of you stayed there, but don't worry about it. and you go through a fish stage and you live through all your evolutionary history. And it's got a grandeur to it. It's got an amazing grandeur that what you have is evolution is going somewhere. And he actually made a religion around it called monism. And monism tried to bring together religion, faith, all those things, and basically it was a materialistic faith that said this idea of the continuation of life getting better and better as you continually add better stages to your development. The phrase was recapitulation, or the biogenic law. The idea that you race through your evolutionary history to become an adult. Now, Garstang, as a marine biologist, having studied all those tiny little bits of plankton, knew that that was nonsense. Because anyone at all who does a plankton class, and if you've never done a plankton class, get enrolled for one somewhere. Have them going here. Go and look at some plankton. They're totally amazing. Particularly if you know what the adults look like. Because very often they don't look anything like the adult at all. Two totally different life forms almost. And Garstang knew that. And what he did in the Easter class that Alistair Hardy sat through in 1921, and I'm sure Alistair wasn't looking across at Sylvia, he was listening very intently to this. He would take a piece of chalk and he would go up to the board, it's called multimedia, and he would use coloured chalk and he would draw the different larval stages and how a creature went from a single egg right through to an adult. And what he would do was point out what he saw as the adaptations on the way. And his big thing was, it doesn't matter what age you are, Darwin's idea of natural selection works. It doesn't just add things on at the end. Haeckel's idea is called terminal addition, where the only evolutionary event is something that's dumped on the end. I'm a fish. Yeah, okay, you got a fish. Here you go, have a bit of reptile. Oh, got a bit of reptile now. Yeah, no, a bit of human. And you just add the bits on the end. And the whole thing Garstang taught his students, right through the Easter class, the first one he started in 1895, he was still doing it in 1921, was that that was rubbish. Marine animals showed that that was a rubbish idea and it didn't work. Natural selection worked to every part of development. And in fact, if evolution worked in terms of changing timings, what happened was it was when you did things that was important. Not that you added one thing onto another, but you could do some things earlier, some things later. It's called heterochrony, an idea which has come to dominate biology, particularly biology that links development, evolution, and ecology. And so what we have here is Haeckel's diagrams of animals reliving their evolutionary history. Now, Haeckel was so convinced that this was true that he didn't actually bother to use the actual drawings. He just used drawings of fish to illustrate the human case because he knew it was true. It sounds a bit bizarre, but the power of knowing what's true and then finding it. How do you discover something unless you know it's there? Have you ever thought of that? Something I say to students all the time, how do you discover something unless you know it's there? So this idea, Garstang said, no way, this just does not work. What's really interesting is that everyone who went to his Easter class and saw the multimedia presentation thought, that's right. He wrote it up for the British Association of Science and published it in 1923. It is dense and incomprehensible. He can certainly give lectures, but that lecture that he gave and wrote down is incomprehensible, and people ignored it. They actually didn't take it on board. So here was a man who was actually putting forward an idea which showed that recapitulation, this great unifying theory in biology, was actually something that didn't work if you believed in Darwin. And yet, it didn't catch on, because he couldn't communicate it except when he was talking to people face to face. And all the people who were there, and we've got lists of them, they all got it, and many of them went on to actually show that the theory was false. What's really interesting, and here's the link, this is the link with Newth and the link with Garstang, is that this idea of looking at the development of marine animals and looking at how development changes, not by adding things on, but by the fact that the way you put yourself together, you can take something that normally happens early in development and make it come a bit later, and make something that's a bit later come a bit earlier, and you can actually change, if you like, the modules, the way that a marine animal is put together, and you still end up with what we call a viable phenotype, something that lives at the end of it. Now, Garstang's idea was that recapitulation was wrong, but this heterochrony, changing the time of things, was everything. And that was his big advance, if you like, the thing he's regarded well for. The problem with doing that is, again, if any of you have ever done any developmental work, the problem with creatures that live is the fact that they do live and you can't just switch them off. You know, you can't get to 6:15 and say, oh, I'm absolutely whacked, switch it off, and I'll come back and watch it develop in the morning. It doesn't matter. If you go away, they still develop. And at first, when we started to do this, we had this poor girl who sat in a 15 degrees temperature room and was terrified to go to the bathroom in case she missed something. Because you can watch for days and days, and all of a sudden something big will happen. And if you've gone for a pee, you're stuffed. And all that time's worthless. So what we did was, she did survive, she got her PhD, and she's now living a normal life, which is good. But we started to develop, this guy here, Ollie Tools, is a postdoc in our lab. He started to develop a way of looking at individual developing marine animals. We can do 300 marine animals at the one time, watching the development all of the time. That's what we can do just now. And it allows us to do what Garstang really did want to do, look at the variation between individual animals. You can't do that without the technology. The other beauty of this technique is once you've got the little creatures in here, the machine systems, and this work has just been funded by Merck. Something must have gone wrong somewhere. And what we're now trying to do is actually the sorts of events that Garstang noticed and wrote down because he sat there with the microscope, we're trying to get the computer to recognise those. So that when you've got 300 individuals going at once, the computer says, oh, heart started, and the heart's 25 beats per minute, without you having to look at it. So, within Plymouth, just at literally less than a kilometre from where Garstang gave his great talks, we have this sort of stuff going on, and carrying on his tradition. The idea for doing that came from David Newth's book, where he sat down, I had a tutor called Roy Croson, who was the world expert in not spiders, that was his wife, in beetles. And Roy Croson believed in recapitulation. And anyone who said that they weren't, he was willing to take you on, basically. Newth said, no, it's not as simple as that. This whole idea of being able to mix development up and it's a bit of a mosaic. He says, that's the future. And in his book, he actually says, there's something about looking at development and looking at how the animals function. The person that can put that together is going to be good. That's what it says in the book. That's what he said in the lectures. That's what we're trying to do. But I won't show you any of the results of that. Why am I telling you this? Because Garstang at this moment in time is criticised for being someone that just had a bit airy-fairy. All his ideas were a bit too speculative. He wrote in 1928 a paper in the British Association for the Advancement of Science again. This one's not quite so dense, but one of the things that he wrote almost in his own defence, is I have sought to keep morphological facts clearly distinguishable from interpretations. What I can see, hear, smell, see and touch, that's that. What I make of that is different, and I know the difference between them. Because his critics, even today, are saying that he doesn't know the difference, and that it's a lot of flights of fancy. But then he adds this part, even if every conclusion should turn out untenable, there are times when it's useful to throw open the windows of of the mind wide open. I actually think that's quite cool. I don't know. For someone who is so meticulous in the way they put evidence together and so really careful about the science and the data means something, to then say, hey, but every once in a while, just open your mind and see what happens. I actually think it's quite cool. It makes science creative rather than just a technical exercise. That he gave to Alistair Hardy. Plankton of the mind. Where did that come from? That was a rather sort of, it wasn't so much a barbed comment, because Julian Huxley was actually Alistair Hardy's tutor at Oxford, and liked him and was a lifelong friend. So it's not as nasty as it sounds, but there's a little bit of a hint of, what would you call it? Not annoyance, but just awkwardness in it. Huxley remarked that Alistair had begun by studying the plankton in the oceans, moved on to the plankton in the air. He literally did. He caught things that were miles up. And this whole idea of looking at patchiness in animals, he applied to things that lived in the air. Well, at least small things. Barnacle geese he didn't really include, although he quite liked them. And it seemed now he was investigating the plankton of the mind. What was he talking about? He was talking about the fact that in the 1940s, after he got his FRS, Alistair, his whole view started to change. He was Lineker professor at Oxford, and he started to concentrate much more on what he thought science actually meant rather than the science itself. And a lot of the plankton stuff, he still continued, but it was very much secondary to his main interests. And this is where Hardy and Garstang meet. 3rd of December 1927, he's come back from the voyage where he's gone down to the Southern Oceans. He's done all this meticulous stuff. He's done quite a lot of stuff. He's got quite a good CV, apart from his writing up. It's not terribly good. But notice what he says. This is a letter that he writes to Walter Garstang. He's been dating his daughter for about 5 or 6 years. He is dreadfully worried that this eminent Walter Garstang, who really puts forward really big ideas, defends them, uses evidence, only evidence, he's really terrified that this guy is going to say, you can't marry my daughter because you're not a good scientist. Why? Because Alistair had a number of what he refers here to as religious difficulties. When he was 16 and 17, he had various experiences, almost you could call them mystical experiences, which he didn't know really what to do with. And then when he went up to Oxford, he's a member of Exeter College, and in his room at Exeter College, he writes in his diary, my whole life will be dedicated to bringing together science and faith in a way that is intellectually respectable. That is my solemn vow. And he writes that as a vow for himself. Having written that, the war happens, he goes into discovery, and that disappears. He's busy being a scientist. But obviously, the thoughts and feelings haven't disappeared. Why would a scientist reject faith? Well, because it's not full of facts. He rejects faith because he knows that his relationship with his wife is not going to work because she shares a different belief system from him, he thinks. In fact, Sylvia's responses to him, she's really quite an understanding. She must have been amazing, actually. I've got a wife like Sylvia, someone who actually understands the mental sort of impasse that goes on in my head. And she's actually really sympathetic with him, but he keeps on going on about the, oh no, she's going to reject me. But really, he was terrified to say to Walter Garstang, I've got these thoughts. That's the only thing that I know about, and that's having talked to Hardy's family as well, the only thing I know about where he actually said to Garstang, look, there's these sort of belief things. And he was really basically scared in case he was going to be told he couldn't marry his daughter. What's fascinating to me is when I picked up Garstang's diaries from the MBE and started to read through them, I did it because I wanted to understand where this man got his ideas about putting recapitulation in its place. Right? I wanted to understand how he understood evolution and development because I thought that would be really neat, and it's detailed. But his diaries are detailed, but only a small part, actually, dedicated to the biology. Most of it is with a spiritual struggle that's gone inside him. 1888, he's 20 years of age. He's up. He's already been ill. He just got his degree. And he's still not terribly well. And he's just wondering what's going on, trying to make his way in the world. And these diaries, which he's marked private, he's brought from Blackburn, where he was born in the 1860s. In here is a man, or at least a boy, trying to become a man and trying to work out what it means to hold down a steady job, but also, what do you do with all these things that are going on that are not science, but are your life? Interestingly enough, he records things like this. This is a part from his diary. It says, I feel to have arrived as near absolute truth as possible. And he talks about some sort of experience which he's having. And his diaries are actually, every couple of months, are full of this, before and after his mother dies, where he has experiences and he doesn't quite know what to do with them, and he doesn't know who to talk to about them. It's interesting because the period covers the first 3 years of the MBE, Marine Biology Association, and he goes and he's sitting with friends, Cunningham and Bourne. These are people who work at the MBE. Now, they're scientists, so he doesn't say anything to them. But then he finds out that Bourne's sister has got some sort of faith, and then he has. And the three of them who sat in this room and taught science together every Wednesday had never actually talked to one another about the sort of mess that was going on inside. And maybe that's not a problem. Maybe that's not a problem. I mean, they're there to talk science. But it sort of takes him by surprise when you see it in his diary. And all the way through his diary, you see this up and down. Something is going on. Even some of the words that he uses are almost identical to what Alistair has already used in his own diary. for me, irrespective of what you make of that, the irony of this man, Alistair Hardy, who has got these mixture of feelings of being human being inside him, and scared to approach the man who's going to be his father-in-law, particularly about matters of faith or things which are not see, hear, smell, see and touch, but not actually knowing that his prospective father-in-law has actually gone through the same sorts of stuff. And I don't really know, but that just seems to me, whatever else you think about it, a bit sad. Because scientists, we are human beings. Courage, do we not bleed? I was once told by one eminent gentleman when I went to a scientific conference, I said, why do you have this conference between Christmas and New Year? It's a bit awkward. He says, it's not awkward if your family's left you. His diaries are all about that struggle. By the time you come to 1892, it sort of disappears. It disappears. He joined the YMCA, he went to churches, he did all sorts of things searching. But by the time 1892 comes, it has subsided basically, or at least in his diaries it subsided, and I certainly can't find any evidence of it for the next 40, 50 years of his life. It was something that happened when he was very young. But the fact he went through that, but his son-in-law, who was going through the same sort of thing, had no idea. When Hardy got his FRS, Fellow of the Royal Society, as I say, his interests changed and he started to talk more openly about what made him tick. And here's a piece called Zoology Outside the Laboratory. He just hacked off Aberdeen University by taking up a professorship, and then when Oxford said, do you want one? Okay, down he went. So there was a lot of chaos going on, but he wrote this at the time, Zoology Outside the Laboratory, and it's all about why fieldwork is important. Right? That's what it's about, why fieldwork is important. Let's read it. Right. It says, we've read it just now at the top. I've stressed the necessity for more pure research in field zoology to provide a foundation for a better knowledge of the factors governing our food supply. Same sort of thing that Garstang was interested in with the fish and the plankton. He wants to know how to safeguard our food supply. That indeed is urgent. Okay, that's urgent. Then there's the word but, small word, first step to disappointment. But to my mind, such research is important for a much more fundamental reason. Man does not live by bread alone, quote from Jesus' words in Matthew. Not man as most of us respect him. If he does come so to live, and it's a possibility, guided by a philosophy of materialism, either classical or dialectical, our civilization will change. A little knowledge is certainly a dangerous thing. Who can doubt that the roots of the last two wars were not nourished to a large extent upon a philosophy of materialism? And this is the key thing, because that sounds negative, and too small a knowledge of the working of evolution. Now, this is way out of the realms of talking about how science works. And many people could focus on the anti-materialism that's there, and it's certainly there strong. But what's driving him, as we see for the rest of his life, from the 1940s onwards, is this thing about we have too small a knowledge of the working of evolution. That's what actually drives him. He retires. He retires in 1963 from his Linacre professorship. And what does he do? He immediately starts doing research. But instead of doing the natural history and biology of plankton or the various other animals he was interested in, he started doing it on man as a religious organism. And he focused all his research into taking what he'd done as a biologist studying the plankton. And he said, why don't we study human beings and their religious experience in exactly the same way? He was asked to give the Gifford Lectures, which are a nice Scottish university thing. A bit strange, giving the Gifford Lectures, because you normally give it to a theologian. This is a biologist. And out of it came these two books, The Living Stream and The Divine Frame. A whole load of other books as well. In fact, there's about 10 books that he wrote, trying to put together a biology of human beings as an evolutionary product and a religious animal. This is why Huxley had said to him, you know, it's the plankton in the mind. Huxley thought he'd gone too far on this. But it was interesting that it was when he thought he was established with his FRS and the knighthood just after that, that he started to speak about what was on his mind, and that vow he'd made back in 1914, he started to fulfil. So for him, a lot of the stuff with the plankton was actually only, if you like, a practicing for applying the biology to his big issue. A little bit from zoology outside the laboratory, because it could sound like a very arrogant man. Here's a little bit where he says, "We fool ourselves if we imagine that our present ideas about life and evolution are any more than a tiny fraction of the truth yet to be discovered in the almost endless years ahead." That's what he wanted to do with his life. He wanted to discover more and more about life and evolution. He wasn't trying to justify faith or justify this or justify that. He was trying to find out what life and evolution actually meant to human beings. And that was his main quest. And it was something which, if you talk to his family say they had no idea. He actually, if he didn't hide it, he certainly didn't promulgate it. I have no idea what Walter Garstang actually thought, because I haven't seen anything written down. But we know that in this case, this was something that drove him, but he never actually shared it with very many people. Finally, we're almost done, for those of you who have had a nice sleep. Plankton in pictures and performance. I love this. I love that. I love what you're doing with the art, because it's just so important. It's not just sort of add on, arty farty, bring them in so we can get better joint funding. It's really, really. Oh, well, that's good. Don't let me knock it. It's brilliant. But the idea of using genuine multimedia, the government thinks they know what multimedia is when it comes to education. I don't know if they can spell the word education, but they certainly don't know what a multimedia approach is. This book is a multimedia approach to biology, The Open Sea. It changed lives. This is a book by Alistair Hardy, The World of Plankton, all the stuff he did in the plankton. While he's working on all these human problems, which he sees are most important, he spends ages and ages writing a book, supposed to be two books, supposed to be one very big book, then turned into two books. And he illustrates it throughout because he's an amazing artist, and he draws things from life, and he paints things from life, particularly watercolours. And what we have here is not just fine writing, yeah, it's out of date, not just fine writing, but absolutely beautiful descriptions about how biology works, with beautiful illustrations of what that working biology looks like. They're absolutely gorgeous. And you could just flick through it. You could actually just flick through it and not even read it, and you get a lot of the sense of what Hardy's trying to do. These are little bits of plankton drawn from life. He's sitting on a ship most of the time, going up and down, as you were saying, not listening to the snapping shrimps, but trying to hold the microscope still. And drawing and painting with watercolours, these things. The reason the book took so long to write, I mean, it was only 12 years overdue. Some publishers just get out of, just get all wrong. And it was because he wanted to finish off going out on cruises and do the final paintings, because it really mattered to him that people could see these beautiful works of art which would communicate science as well as being aesthetically absolutely beautiful. And if you don't have a copy, try and get a copy. Not the black and white New Naturalist reprint, but the original one with the hardbacks. And absolutely fantastic. Even if you don't like biology, just go through it. It's an amazing experience. These are ostracods. Ostracods are great. They're not even, for those who know, they're not even proper crustaceans anymore, which really breaks my heart. They're absolutely beautiful. Creatures that look as if they should be crawling around, but they don't. They float in the plankton. Some of them are really, really big. And then you've got the calanoid copepods, for those, just to show you I do know a bit of biology in plankton. His book, Great Waters, is one of the finest written biology books I've ever come across. And I was given it as a present after I was tempted to take this away. I was in Vancouver Island. I was tempted to take it away with me, but then I just thought, that's called stealing. And you can take the man out of Glasgow, but you can't take Glasgow out. So I asked my wife to buy me a copy of it, because I thought it would be sort of interesting. It's one of the best introductions to zoology that I've ever encountered. It's written in the 1960s, totally and utterly out of date. But if you want to start the study of marine animals, with the proviso that a lot of the information is out of date, this is a good place to start. He writes absolutely beautiful about travelling down to the southern oceans, what he sees, what he does, the introduction to the groups, the natural history, the ideas. The book's full of ideas. It's not just describing things. And his ideas are magnificent, but based on hard fact, not just supposition. Interestingly enough, Garstang, this is terrible. In my opinion, can't write for toffee. I know that's classic for me, and any of you have ever reviewed any of my papers, and you're just sitting there thinking, you have no idea, boy. But you know, but given the strength of this man's mind, his writing is not great, but I tell you something, he was a great communicator. And he was a great communicator, particularly when he used poetry and drama. Here's from one of his letters from 1886 to his mother, and he says, wrote to Flory a letter in verse. And one of the things he was really good at was writing poetry. And he used that poetry, not by printing it out, but by going into Easter class with these marine biologists and actually reciting the poetry to them. Without going into too much detail, snails have a little twist early on in their early development. Right, don't worry about it. If you want to know, I'll tell you afterwards. But they have a little twist, and no one knows why. Why would you put your bum above your head? It's just not a good idea, which is what the snails do. And so as a way of trying to explain theories behind it, he wrote the Ballad of the Villager. The villager just means a baby snail, or how the snail got its twist. The villager's a lively float, the liveliest afloat. And it's great stuff. It sounds really good, and you can hear the students laugh, but it's deadly serious. And what we talked about recapitulation, he actually wrote stuff which was really incisive about this idea of recapitulation, goes straight to the heart of the matter, really hacking people off. But he did it in a way that was funny. Sing a song of six legs in euphyletic stage, 4 and 20 isopods working in a cage. Now, that's sing a song of six, for those that don't know and don't recognise, I'm really sorry for the singing. I sing a song of sixpence, right? And it's about isopods and woodlice and stuff. And then next verse, McBride was in his counting house, counting out his leg, his counting phylogenies. And McBride was the professor of... McBride was the professor of embryology at Glasgow in 1916. This guy was an arch recapitulationist, and anyone that tried to publish anything different, McBride would just cut them off. And so here was Garstang in front of the class, just poking fun at McBride's ideas in a really savage way. It was never in print, but it was there, and all the people who were going to become the scientific elite were hearing, this guy's a plonker. Right? It was really, really effective. It was effective, and yet he couldn't get it to a wider audience. It took the people that he educated and the people that they educated them to finally get the idea across. The whole idea of recapitulation only really died, in my view, in 1995, when a friend of mine called Mike Richardson. We were talking about Garstang's ideas and how he tried to use media to try and get rid of this idea that animals relive their evolutionary history. And Mike said, well, the only way to get an idea which is based on visual information, which is based on art, which is what Heichel's thing is, it's the pictures, you can see the fish stage, you can see all the different stages, is to fight fire with fire. So what Mike did was he went to an abattoir or somewhere and got in museums and got lots of little developmental stages of lots of vertebrates and arranged them roughly in the same way as that Heichel would arrange them, where you could see the perfect evolution running through their forms, and then took a picture of it. Hold on. That's the picture of it. And you've got lampreys, dogfish, all the way up to human beings. And even although he does a detailed scientific description of it, this appearing on the back page, half page of the Telegraph, actually changed people's mind. This was the death knell of recapitulation. Not the beautiful arguments that he made, or that Gavin De Beer, or Stephen Jay Gould, who's a great popular writer, made. He did a whole book, Ontogeny and Phylogeny, trying to nail this. But it was the picture which made the difference. Now, it's got solid science behind it, but it was the picture that made the difference by Mike Richardson. As a follow-up to that, what's really interesting is that that was the day that recapitulation died, except for molecular biologists, and they've reinvented it again. And it's now back in the literature again, where we're talking about recapitulation and living through evolutionary stuff. So it'll be interesting to see how to tackle that one. Right, so finally, I'd be glad to know, Plankton of the Sea. You'll notice I've made an argument, careful in fact, but still creative. The idea that you're really careful, that it really matters that you know your stuff, and then what you do with that stuff, as long as you know the difference between the two things, that's great. We need to know, we need to have people who know their stuff, or at least I did think so until Michael Grove said this. I think the people in this world, I don't think, have you had enough of Garstang? Have you had enough? of Hardy? No, I mean, because you see the way that they actually care about things that they're looking at. And to hear an expert speak, and particularly when they know that this is what I know and this is what I think, to be able to differentiate the two things is a great thing. So there's a bit of a challenge. Second challenge, this is from the Mouse of St. Alistair. Plankton the mind, covert in faith. I gave a talk at the Sir Arthur Hardy Foundation, and they asked me to talk on Alistair Hardy, the man in his life. And I thought, yeah, okay, so this is a 3-day scientific conference. This is going to be great. An hour long on the man, and not his life, the man in his faith. So I gave the talk, and I gave a lot of the information I've given you, but much more, and particularly from his diaries and from other sources. And at the end, for the 3 days of the conference, I had people coming up to me, all sorts of eminent scientists, and saying, there's some talk. Do you know, when I was 14, and they would tell me a story, and then somebody else would come up and say, yeah, what you said, very controversial. He said, I know we're not supposed to believe this. And I heard that phrase, I know we're not supposed to believe this, 4 or 5 times. And it just made me think, irrespective of what your position is and what you believe, isn't it wrong as people that care about people not to be able to communicate? And particularly scientists who want to communicate and to hear each other's stories. I put this in really just because I think it caused a real stir at the time. Alistair wrote this in his Zoology Outside the Laboratory. To proclaim that organic behaviour is the product of mechanism as we ordinarily understand it, to my mind, is unreasonable and as dogmatic as to proclaim the literal interpretation of Genesis. This guy ended up rejecting all formal religion. He didn't see any good in them, even the Unitarians, which he joined, and they're still happy to have him as their champion. We get lots of chances to go and talk in Unitarian churches to tell him about them, but he even said, no, this is not good enough. He wanted to try and understand for himself what was going on, and it just didn't fit with what he was finding round about him. And then finally, Plankton and performance and pictures, creative and communication. Here's a sort of bizarre thing for me. Let me entertain you. I won't sing this one, although if you want to try it, it'd be good. Let me entertain you by Robbie Williams. A lot of scientific communication is now let me entertain you. No. Why? So I can somehow get your attention? It doesn't work. Just entertaining people doesn't work. I talked to a BBC producer, and this guy was saying to me, so what do we do? I said, people get tired of, and there's another blooming big whale that's just jumped out and is about to fall on top of me, and this is amazing, I wish you were here. Now, there's only so long you can... And then eventually your mind has to kick in, and you think, hold on, that whale wouldn't do that, or whatever, there's 10 of them pushing it over. And entertainment's okay for getting attention, but it doesn't seem to help with the education. Garstang's way of using those poems certainly communicated to the people who were right in front of him, but his papers didn't. Alistair Hardy's pictures communicate to anyone, no matter who they are, even to children. They communicate really well. They're beautifully done, they're pieces of art, but they actually communicate. And I suppose my question is this. Is this all it is? Let me entertain you. When we talk about scientific outreach and reaching out, from these guys, I don't think it is. I think there's something substantial which certainly brings entertainment, but entertainment is not the thing that they were aiming to do. They were aiming to communicate stuff that they care passionately about, and it just so happens it turned out to be extremely entertaining. And with that, I finish well ahead of time.
So that was a real treat for me, because in fact, in my former office, actually, in the Royal Society of Foundation, I got several of the Hardy's original paintings on my office wall.
Put in my bag.
I was going to say, the other thing that I was going to say as well was that I'm going to check my bookshelves, and I left you alone in my office. And there were many of those Hardy books, and the Plankton, and his more recent ones on his religious experiences and so on in there. At least they were there.
No, they're still there.
John, that was absolutely fabulous. Thank you so much. That was a real tour de force. And wonderful. We've got a small gift for you.
which I think will, I would like to think, you know, you would...
Small whiskey bottle?
Well, no. We'll be seeing some of this, we'll be seeing some of this shortly, but anyway, we'll have a, this is from one of our creative artistic students.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yes, I just thought...
Like, I could be a real academic by the end of this.
Thank you, that's really lovely.
That's a pleasure, that's a pleasure. Anyway, there's going to be a bit of art meeting science now. There'll be an opportunity to speak to John afterwards in our sort of networking section when we get through in the other room. So John, that was fabulous, thank you so much. Right.
Just a word of advice.
That was a glorious thing to listen to. And of course, arts and sciences belong together. It's where they started out. This is not a meeting, it's a re-encounter of arts and sciences. And just to listen to having to know your stuff and have the technical thing and then be creative and exploring. John was talking about music just as much as he was about science. And that's why we find this particular side of our musical lives, exploring all sorts of different things, such a very satisfying thing. And just to do some of the science bit of this next piece, which is really something quite special. It brings in a whole lot of different people, but a lot of, Nick's very modest, even when his wife's slagging him off. He's very modest about what he does in the studio with the sounds that he harvests from the world around him. You'll hear a little of his expertise in particular here, which is in manipulating the sounds to bring them out into true music. So whenever you're hearing things that sound like harmony or melody, they have come from the world around, and it's just harvesting the harmonics and giving us something to play with. And it's really very special. And if any of you are still doubting the connection between arts and sciences, I have to say that it's absolutely obvious to me that scientists and musicians are kindred spirits, because describing lab work is just the same as trying to run a rehearsal. So we're there with you all day and then bursting into tears at the end. That's us too. So. This is a song written by Sean Cooney from the Teesside a cappella trio, The Young Uns. It's the story of two young men from Syria, Hesham Mwadamani and his friend Ferris Abu Khalil, who were escaping the privations of their homeland and trying to find a new life in which they could bring their families over. They reached Turkey and couldn't afford the people smugglers' fare to get across in the boats that would sink anyway. So they decided to swim, and they did this at night beneath the starlight. And theirs is a happy story, because they did reach with assistance of people waiting on the other side who helped them ashore. They made a new life. And I think it would be good to remember that in amongst all the Trump nonsense of this week, that people in Aleppo and in the rest of Syria and in Iraq are still in the same situation. Mama, I hit the road. We couldn't pay the smuggler's fare, nor fly above the sea. We had to swim to make it there. Dark water carried Thank you. Could you show your appreciation, please, for on red laptop, Nick Turner? Whose fevered brain is behind all of this, and also one of our most regular partners in crime, and an equally intense and imaginative and just fantastic musician to work for and with, local boy Finlay Wells.
Right, we have some more for you. Where's Jessica? Oh, here you are, Jessica, right, excellent. So, you've got a small presentation.
Yes, yes, just 10 minutes.
Okay, and how is that? Oh.
Good afternoon, beautiful music and really interesting talk. We are just giving a short talk about our work together, our collaboration with it just recently, and Ruth Patterson, PhD student here at SAMS, is starting, and yeah.
So, hi, my name's Ruth. I'm a final year PhD student here at SAMS, and I've been here 7 years now, to say. So yeah, I'll be finishing up in April, and I've been given the great task of summing up everything there is to know about embryological blooms in 5 minutes. So here we go. So reasons we love phytoplankton, and we've already covered this in great detail already. Phytoplankton are great, first of all, because they look so beautiful. And their diversity of their shape and all of their different colours just gives us a little bit of information about how much of a diverse group that they are and how much they do for our planet. So to start with, they make enormous blooms in the ocean, and this is a bloom of Emiliana huxleyi in the English Channel in 1999. They fuel the carbon pump, so they take a lot of carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, regulating our planet, sequestering carbon in the deep oceans, and second thing is they support our great food chain, so we've already talked a lot about food supply. If we didn't have our phytoplankton, we wouldn't have half of the oxygen on the planet, and we also wouldn't be able to have all of the whales, the birds, the shellfish, and the fish that grow in the oceans. But it's possible to have too much of a good thing. And what happens when things get a bit dicey? So what is a HAB? What's a harmful algal bloom? And why is it a big deal? Why should we care? So a harmful algal bloom is described when algae begin to have a deleterious effect to humans, wildlife, and the local environment. So a bloom is like out of control growth. And this isn't always linked to toxicity, so everybody thinks that a harmful algal bloom has always got to be toxic. That's not the case. And we can also have low biomass blooms, and these are usually linked to production of toxicity. And they can be equally harmful as high biomass blooms. And both types have huge economic losses, and it's really difficult to accurately quantify what the loss of a harmful algal bloom is. Harmful algal blooms can affect tourism, the economy, shellfish production, fisheries, huge parts of the localist ecosystem that we just don't fully understand. So I'm going to go through three examples of major harmful algal blooms that you might have seen on the news recently. So the Florida state of emergency that happened in 2016. So there was a massive cyanobacteria bloom in, sorry for the pronunciation, Lake Okeechobee. In Florida, there was a massive cyanobacteria bloom which covered 85 square kilometres in this freshwater lake. And what happened was they had a lot of heavy rain, and the water level of the lake rose so much they had to divert some of the water into the sea. And this is the perfect inoculum. It goes out into the sea, reduces the salinity of the marine environment, and you get a massive cyanobacteria bloom. And everyone's like, oh my god, how did this happen? This is how this happened. So the governor of California declared a state of emergency, and there was a lot of trouble with people not being able to use the beaches, it stank, it was toxic, it was just a massive issue for the, and we still don't know how much was lost by the local economy. You can see centimetres thick mats of cyanobacteria in the local area. Second, there was an unprecedented toxic diatom bloom in 2016 that covered most of the North Pacific, mainly covering the coastal region of North America. And this was linked to an unusually warm surface waters of the North Pacific, 2 to 3 degrees plus temperature anomaly. So this is not a net sample. This is just a scoop taken out the surface of the water off the coast of Oregon of toxic pseudonyxia, which produces domoic acid. And this was a sea lion. It was found to occur all up the food chain by accumulating in large mammals. This sea lion was having a seizure on the beach. It was full so much of domoic acid. There were massive whale strandings. The crab fisheries had to be closed. This was a massive environmental incident. And this has just been published this year, so there's any scientists out there and want to read the paper, you can read the paper. And then an example closer to home, we had a Shetland shellfish product recall in 2013, when 70 people in London restaurants got sick from eating toxic shellfish. And the toxins were caused by this little organism, Dynophysis. And actually this research was done by some very clever people in this institute, and it was linked by westerly winds of Dynophysis in the North Atlantic being blown onto the Shetland Islands. So this signifies that this is a low biomass bloom. Dynophysis only need to be present in about 100 cells per liter to become toxic in shellfish, whereas the other ones are really, really high concentration. And this also shows that you don't need to have growth in the place where you see the effects. Blooms and effects can be blown in from other areas. And you can also read the paper published by Callum White, who is here in the audience today. So this is going over a few of the effects that we find. It's very complicated to tease out, and they're very difficult to quantify the effects. High biomass, they have a visual and a sensory harm to people. They look gross, they smell bad, they're slimy, and they impact our beautiful beaches and our tourism. But then after the bloom crashes, bacteria move in, they aerobically digest the material, oxygen levels go down, and this can cause anoxia and hypoxia, essentially suffocating the marine life inside the environment. Toxins can produce both in high and low biomass blooms, and different toxins are produced by many different species. So we've got a lot of different complicated chemistry going on here, and these toxins can have many different effects. You can have human health issues, inclusion are shellfish poisoning syndromes, aerosols, and aerosols are when a toxic bloom is being stirred up by wave action. The toxin is ejected into the atmosphere, and then people and marine mammals breathe in these toxins, and you get a very difficult respiratory problem. And this happens a lot in the Gulf of Mexico. Marine food web effects, which we really don't know the full extent of. In Argentina, they have whale strandings every year. With high concentrations of acid, domoic acid in their systems. And these effects may not be linked to high biomass, and of course all of these things have a massive commercial and tourism impact that we just don't know the full extent of. And this was one of the main reasons why we wanted to do this collection, me and Jessica, because harmful algal blooms, people just think of them as being red tides and that's it. So you have the colour, first of all harmful algal blooms aren't red, all harmful algal blooms aren't high biomass, and you get a myriad of different effects which aren't just linked to the toxicity. So of course, number one, you've got biotoxin production, and then you've got foam and slime formation. So you have this species called Phaeocystis, and it lives in a polysaccharide gel matrix. And when that's stirred up by the waves, you get these massive banks of foam, and that gets blown onto the coastal zone. And there was what in Aberdeen, you got like 6 feet waves of foam just engulfing the coastal towns. And you know, that's difficult for the town to go about its day-to-day activities. You've got water discoloration, and you get red, yellow, blue, green, all sorts of different colors. Low oxygen anoxia causing fish kills, and you can see all these fish floating on the surface of a harbor. And then you've also got mechanical damage to fish gills. So this is a cautotera species that have spines, and they puncture fish gills and irritate so that the fish aren't able to absorb oxygen from their environment anymore, and they can have long-term health effects and even suffocate and die. And this can be a problem with enclosed harmed wild blooms around fish farm cages. And this leads us nicely into our flora collection, which was based around these five themes. And Jessica's going to talk a little bit about crew bag.
Yes, now we have to make this beautiful. So we try. So before we go into how we collaborated, I would like to give a brief, very short introduction about crew bag and what we do. We say on our website and on Twitter that we use the evocative power of design to create luxury textiles inspired by the beauty and hidden secrets of the oceans. But what that means, so what do we really do? And in terms of being practical, we create printed textiles inspired by marine science. We create products that have integrated science outreach. So we establish collaborations. We say that we are an icebreaker because when we are at conferences and events, people come, approach the textiles, and it helps to start conversations between different stakeholders. We are trying to develop a new sense of luxury. We don't do mass production, so we create high-end products because there is a lot of work involved in developing the science outreach, in creating the content, the booklets, in trying to, we only use natural fabrics. And everything is made in the UK and Scotland, and the scarves and pocket squares are finished in Italy. So we put a lot of thought in there, and we're trying to combine cutting-edge research and interesting projects with craftsmanship and a tangible product that people can feel and touch. And here is an example of the work, and this is the screenshot of our website and Twitter. We communicate through different platforms, and we are launching a new website very soon. People can buy the product, or they can come to another exhibition and have a look at it, and they can take the booklet with them and read about it, the content, and then you can go to the website or follow the social media platforms. But why? And that's, I think, it's more important, and comes back to what John was saying in his talk, because it's about facts, but it's also about space for thinking and feeling. And I am not a scientist. Well, I have a background in marine science. I did an undergraduate degree here at SAMS, and I didn't know what to do afterwards. My life as a student wasn't that easy. I wasn't very healthy throughout my studies, and I got an immense amount of support from SAMS to finish my studies. And I wanted to follow with a master's and do a PhD. I started as a mature student. I changed careers. I was a horse trainer before, a show jumper, and then I worked as a consultant for 7 years. So, and I wanted to go back to my childhood dream to do marine science. But it wasn't a straight line, so it wasn't easy for me. But I tried and I kept going, and thanks to everyone here, I managed. But then I came to the point that I have to decide, and a few years ago I was doing a project with Claire, and after work I went to the pub in Owens, and I had a beer with a friend, a Spanish friend, Teresa. And I think it was the summer with lots of people were wearing scarves with butterflies and flowers, and I have nothing against them, they're really beautiful. But I was wondering, I sat there and we were looking, I think I saw 5 scarves with butterflies. And then I told Teresa, why don't show all the things? You know, as a scientist, we have access to this incredible amount of images and specimens and beautiful ideas and scientists trying to find out about how systems work. And we see so many things that most people will never ever see and will never have access to it. And I just had that desire in me to share that, to share some of these tiny windows that scientists try to discover and open and see and try to reach new audiences by doing that. And so, and when I say here, it's a sense of wonder and love. It's because I've always been intrigued by and fascinated by the beautiful planet, by how systems, by the interconnected systems, our climate system, ocean, atmosphere, everything's fascinating and connected. And I used to pray a lot before I decided to do crew bag. I also had some, I'm not ashamed to say that I believe in science, yes, and I think evolution is a really interesting way how to explain how things work, but I also believe in God, and I pray a lot, and I needed to decide what to do, so I had a really support from my husband, from SAMS, from everyone had this idea, and I had the opportunity to go and see what happened. So it just happened. And so 2 years ago, I founded Krubach, and so I was about to promote marine science and promote environmental education to reach bigger new audiences. And also why I do it, because I like beautiful things. We all like beautiful things. We all like to have beautiful clothes, a beautiful home. We like to look at flowers. Beauty is everywhere. And try to see beauty in difficult things, and we connect with beauty. And if I'm able to connect a difficult subject, although I'm not always wanting to have mother blooms or pathogens, I'm also like deep sea fish or sea stars. But just saying, if we can connect, if people can connect emotionally with a subject, they start to care about it. We have this with the charismatic species like polar bears or marine mammals. People love them, they're cute, they're interesting. But what about harmful algal blooms or pathogens or other problems? So, and that's what Krubach tries to do, connect the mind and the heart so people can see the facts, read about them, and feel and touch and have that space for thinking. And I use art and design as an artist. I use abstraction. And I don't tell all the details of the inspiration because I share the facts, but I don't say why I did the patterns the way I did it completely, because I want people to see themselves in the art and I want people to have their own emotional connection to it. And then when they read the facts, they can have their own complete experience of mind and heart and body. And also another reason, more practical, I believe in knowledge-based economy. I think it's very important to promote facts, to allow society to develop based on the findings of science, influencing policy making. And I've been invited to, for the third time, I just been 2 weeks ago to the National Economic Forum in Edinburgh. I've been invited to policy meetings on marine protected areas. I think Krubach is a good place as an icebreaker. And if I can contribute minuscule with just a grain to that, I'm really, really proud of it. Also, it's about using this art for the greater good. I want a profitable business. I created my own job. Of course, I want to make some money to live. But it's also about using design and using it to connect science and people and try to sort of a mess. I hope not speaking too fast. So, the Flora collection. It was inspired by research on harmful algal blooms. We wanted to spark interest and enthusiasm on microalgae and try to share this the knowledge of these five things. We decided that it was not about one specific research project, but the general knowledge. And Ruth and I, we chose this theme. She came to me and said, I think these themes are the more general base and really good to give people an overview of what it means. As difference to other collections, we decided to work under a brief, so to have a disciplined approach to design. So Ruth created a mood board. Just ignore the letters, it's about the colors. So she came to me and said, let's do these colors. And I was happy to it, because in the first two collections, I had completely freedom to develop my inspiration based on the research and use the research images and do my own drawings, do the images to create patterns and abstracts to hear. It was about conveying a knowledge, conveying a meaning for each theme. So the designs have to also explain what they mean. So we have this, we have these colors for damage to fish gills, we have the greens for water discoloration. Here was very difficult for anoxia. Yes, then we have cyanophore formation and biotoxin production. And Ruth was really good. And this is something I like to mention also. Collaboration is more than assuming the different parts. We interacted, she took part into my creative work, I took part into the development of the science outreach. We have also reviewers and copywriters, so it's about team effort, a teamwork in creating something more and interesting that is different when you just add the parts separately. So if you go back and you see, so So you see the colours, and now I'm going to show you how we develop, so the type of textures we develop. This is damage to fish gills.
Which Jessica's modelling today.
Yes. Yes.
And this is a diatom, Catopterus, and you can see it has loads of big spines on it, and these spines are made up of silica, or glass, essentially. And if that get, I said before, if that gets lodged into fish gills, then that can have a very unhappy fish.
Yes, and so the challenge for me was to show that, to show how dangerous they are to fish, but also make it beautiful and elegant. So we created a repetition pattern, and when you see the close-up, you can see that in the exhibition, you see the details of the spines and also the spines of the chitosaurus. And this is what the discoloration. So as you see, we follow the brief and we follow the mood board really well, and we use cyanobacteria from a friend of mine, Julia Kleintal. She works at Tübingen University, and this the base images used for this work was from a research she'd done in Antarctica, and it was published in Nature magazine. So it was really generous of her to provide us with the images, and so we created a seal scarf that shows the intricate patterns of cyanobacteria cultures, and then we manipulated the colors and the shape of the intricate patterns to create, inspired by the circuits of the computers, to show also how society is built, how cities are built, and how we are interconnected with each other. We developed this design as a seal scarf and also pocket square. Okay, this is a bit tricky. This is anoxia. Does anyone of you see what I tried to show in this design? Can you tell what this is?
Dead fish.
Yes. 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 So it's something really difficult to wear if you think, okay, this is dead fish, but you can also think, well, this is about life and death, this is about what is now, what comes afterwards, and this is also about how nature works, how our natural systems work, and I do find that beautiful, even with that in it. I think that's important, and it's good to think about these things. And we soften it with colors. We use graffiti style drawing, so I did draw these little things by hand, each for everyone. And I decided not to use research images, but just to do the pattern by hand. And then we use the red to show the belly when the blood comes out of the belly, because some of the fish floats the other way around. And that's the design for anoxia. Okay, and so if you want to comment on the species, this is pretty interesting.
So this is for foam and slime formation, and this is the phaeocystis that I was talking about earlier. So this is a research image that was taken down a light microscope from Loch Rearon, which is just our local sea loch, up about a half an hour drive. And you can see that the individual cells form the globs, and then the globs form this one colony, which is the polysaccharide gel matrix. And it's the lightness of the scarf that infers the foam and the bubbles.
And we use research images to create these designs. We're almost done. And this is biotoxin production. See, this is your baby.
So this scarf is based on my PhD. I'm working on a tiny little dinoflagellate called Aesidinium spinosum that was first discovered in 2009. So it's a very recent species, and it was discovered off the coast of Scotland. And it's a biotoxin producer. It produces azospore acid. This is a research image that I took down the microscope. It's one of those long days in the lab where you realise you've taken a sample and it's just too dense for you to count, and you need to go and dilute it. So this is a daffy stained, way too dense culture to do anything with, but it looks beautiful.
With,
of course, with scale bars and everything. And this is me just 5 minutes after giving a presentation in Brazil at the International Society for Harmful Algae's, and it's not an annual conference, it runs every 2 years, but they very kindly funded the development of this of this project. And I felt that these scarves were, they're such a fantastic networking tool at conferences. people would come up to me and talk to me about the scarves and ask me about the research images that were on the designs. And I'd be walking around poster sessions and the president of the society would grab me and come and get me to talk to the guy who organised the conference, and they'd be asking my opinion on Dinophysis advection and off the coast of Brazil, and I'm just like, what am I doing? But it's a very, very useful tool as a researcher and to connect with the public.
Yes. And guess what, we do this, yes. And these are some of the images of combining with the science outreach. We have booklets, you will see them in the exhibition. So we try to present some of the key facts. I don't know much about the facts, but I like to find the people that know about them and try to use my work and my inspiration and my ability to speculate and maybe try to overthink sometimes to combine these and create these collections. And every team that we have is really incredible, being supported by so many people that I cannot place in the school. Okay. It's the conversion. Okay. Yes. So I would like to thank the International Society for the Study of Harmful Algae for kindly believing in our project and financially supporting the development of this. Also to thank SAMS in many ways for the support, for incubating me here, for being able to work and collaborate and speak with scientists. And Anushka has been an incredible mentor since the very beginning. Professor Keith Davison, Corinne Pinsel, and Lisa, for helping us revising the content, having comments, and also editing. Julia for her picture, and my mentors in the textiles and fashion industry, Anne Rich and Pamela Anderson, and of course my husband also for helping me all the time. this shows some of the work we've done in the past, and also we, you know, combining the research, people looking at the microscope, taking research images, and creating different designs. Thank you very much.
Fabulous way to end, actually. I don't think I can even try and compete with that, actually. So and we've had, I think, a really fascinating afternoon. I don't think I can remember an afternoon of such wonderful diversity, yet sort of connectedness as well, in fact, actually. So a theme definitely running through everything that we've seen and heard this afternoon. So thank you all very much for taking part in this. And we do have some refreshments next door, and indeed some there's the exhibition, as we've heard, and some further art through there. So thank you.